Thank you very much for giving us this audience. I'd like to start by asking you, why do you want to become the president of the New Zaire?
I want to become the president of the New Zaire to bring back the hope to the people, to become a voice of the people with no voice, of the voiceless. That's my main focus on that, and to bring reforms, some radical reforms in all sectors. But the most of all, to empower our women.
Now, corruption is one of the biggest challenges in Africa. How do you particularly, and many leaders in Africa say they want to address corruption, but actually they don't, which is the frustrations of millions of Africans who will be watching this video. What is your message, and what in particular are you going to promise to do to address the perennial problem of corruption in Africa?
Corruption first, we have to troubleshoot the problem. Why are we where we are today? In case of my country, there's two sectors that has destroyed the nation. That is our security sector and our judicial sector. Those has been the cancers of the problem that has been caused in our nation. And looking at our women's the majority in our nation, but a minority when it comes in decision making or when it comes in business. Today, if we can really integrate women in our society, like in a decision making, give them voice, you know, that will be the number one way to fight corruption. Looking at it, getting women involved, you know, in decision makings and in high positions. But the most of all, what I'm looking at is just the reforms that we're gonna bring in, the security reform and the judicial reform, where justice, you know, it won't be something that we can just speak lightly about justice. It'll be something that will have effect.
Now, a lot of people say billions have been stolen from New Zaire or the Congo.
The Zaire, yeah.
Now, what are you going to do in particular? And the question a lot of people want answered is, will you bring prosecution against former leaders that have stolen from the Congo?
Everyone, as I say, when you look at it today, the law will be blind. Okay, the law is blind. Everybody who has committed anything in that country will be held responsible. Not by me, but the justice system, which we all, the people, are fighting for all these reforms, this great reform. It will hold each person accountable.
Now let's talk about raw materials.
Yes.
Congo is world renowned for being the heart of raw materials. What is your presidency going to do, particularly in the development of raw materials for Congo?
My focus, my first pillar on that, it is privatization. Okay, how to privatize the what we call artisanal minings. Okay, because if we can privatize artisanal mining, it will help develop that community, that rural area. Because those minings are not in the cities, they're in rural areas. So by privatizing those minings, you know, it will help. First, it's good for the environment. Okay, it will help the environment because people are digging everywhere. But with a responsible company coming in, okay, it will help. Okay, so by then I believe it will create jobs. There'll be job creation because right now there's 98% unemployment in the country, all informal sector. Okay, so how can we leapfrog that? So my best way, I think, by privatizing artisanal mining, where we see children out there working, by privatizing, it will bring a big change for the DRC. That will be a first step.
And then obviously question has always been asked, another thing that's plagued Africa, across Africa, is a question of how does a community benefit from its own raw materials? And we see examples in Nigeria where there's the Niger Delta, oil from that area doesn't benefit the people. What is your presidency going to do to ensure raw materials from a particular area benefits the community that it comes from?
Well, that's what we're tackling on village chiefs, tribal leaders. If today we can get tribal leaders involved in decision making of their land, because at the end of the day, they know their land, they know the limits of their land. So we're getting them involved into the development of the nation. That will be a change that we're all waiting for. And then We've seen the challenges that Nigerians are facing, but let's look at some other places in Africa. Let's look at places like Botswana. How do people of Botswana benefit from their minerals? And we've seen it that worked. So there's so many good things that we can take from the path that has worked. So involving tribal chiefs in decision makings and getting a model as a model of Botswana in place, okay, we can live from that.
Now, the international diaspora, African diaspora, mm-hmm. have been urging and crying out to bring their expertise into Africa to help. But the problem has always been the bureaucracy in getting international African diaspora back into Africa. What is your presidency going to do to the African diaspora in developing the Congo?
Well, thank you for that. I myself am a diaspora. So we have to ask ourselves, what do the diaspora needs to go back? What's stopping them to go back? One thing is security. Second is the rule of law. If we can establish all that, we can create that platform, a platform that will base on the rule of law with right security, those people will come. Secondly, with all those things done, there'll be transparency when it comes in documents. Because I'll give an example in the DRC. To start a company in the DRC takes 190 days. 190 days. So we're reforming that, bringing some real radical reform, bring some change, bringing technology, emerging the new Zaire with the partnering up with the new Zaire with technology. We'll see the change that we all want. So the thing that will ensure that the diaspora, I want to tell the diaspora that there won't be red tapes. Okay, the game is over. What is illegal in America, it will be legal in Congo or the new Zaire. What's illegal in London will be illegal in the new Zaire.
So that's effectively going to be bringing the rule of law in Congo on par with that of Europe and America.
The world, best of the world, because we've learned each part of the world, there's so many things that we can learn from. Because when I look at the world, I see the world as a catalog. When you open a catalog, what can we order? Okay, because you and I cannot invent a wheel. Okay, so there's something that we can learn from everywhere in the world, which can be best for us, and that's the best that we're gonna bring in the new life.
Now, on women empowerment, you mentioned earlier the impact and influence of women in our societies. What is your presidency going to do, particularly in the protection of women's rights and the promotion of their empowerment?
Well, it's for me, on that, that's a real great question. Our first step on that is to educate men about the rights of women in a time of peace and war. Okay, so when we start educating men about the rights of women, that's the empowerment there. Okay, and it's for us too. The empowerment has to start from our houses. Because there's a saying where they say, when you educate a woman, you educate a nation. So today, our women in our nation, they've been considered as second class citizens. So we have to change that narrative. We need to put them in the first positions. Okay. So by starting that and educating in our families, you know, because we see a lot of our mothers, they always favor their boys, they don't favor their daughters.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so that starts from home. So from home, it's for us to have this parental educations and to keep promoting that through media. Okay, how to empower the women, how a woman can have a voice in the society, how a woman can give her opinion. That's something that I'm really, really, really standing for.
Now, to develop the new Zaire, yes. There will be the need for partnership with international clients. What is your experience in bringing trade and development to Africa?
Well, we need to create a space for those investors, because no investors will come to invest in a place where there's no rule of laws. No investor will come to invest in a place where they don't treat their women right. Okay. No investor will come to invest in a place where there's corruptions. So it's for us, the people of New Zaire, together with our investors, to tell out a security which will be favorable for our people and our investors. And it's for us to tailor a judicial system which will guarantee their investments, okay, and protect their investment, because no one is in this business to lose. We're all there to gain. So how can we make it favorable for our investors to come in and feel secure? Okay, so all that, it's hard for me to say if as I can predict it, because a lot of people watching me today, they'll say, oh, Mr. Malanga, that's an utopian dream. Okay, so it's for us to show it, okay, then to say it. But what I can guarantee is that a change is coming. Okay, it's a new generation of Africa. We've learned what we've learned from the West, and then we'll rise in the East. And that's when we're going to rise.
Now, the question is risen about child labor in Congo. And initiatives have come up around the fact that linking the idea of mobile phones and mining in the Congo with the exploitation of child labor. What is your presidency going to do around the protection of child laborers?
Child labor, all those things will fall the second that we start to privatizing those minings. Because we don't see those child laborers in privatized mines. They're not there. You don't see those child laborers in Tanke Fangorume, which is Freeport. You don't see them there. Okay? Where do you see those child laborers? You see them in our own communities, in our own minings. So by privatizing that will tackle the child labor, because privatizing that mining, it will help create a school. It will help create a revenue for the father, because the father of that child, of that miner, will come to work while his child is going to school. Okay, it will bring responsibility. But again, those people are victims. It's time for the government to take responsibility, and that responsibility meaning opening the country for business and privatizing artisanal mining. That's where child labors are found, in artisanal
Precisely.
Mining. Yes.
Moving on to the question around international trade. Could you speak to for example, Brexit in the UK? We're facing the dilemma around Brexit. Is your presidency open to working with UK businesses that are looking to obviously create new relationships with Africa? Is that a possibility?
That's a big possibility. You know, let's get this. The news I hear, it's a blank canvas. Everything must be built in the country, from infrastructure, from nail to a little screw has to be built in that country, to a needle. So the potential is there. Okay. Yes, I can see the difficulty, that the challenges that the UK are facing today. But I want the UK businessmen and all those companies to know that there is hope in the heart of Africa, where we are waiting for them, our hands open. And I understand there's a certain way that they do business. They live with certain principles. And those are the principles that we are going to adopt and enforce in this new regime.